So let us move straight on to our new friend from Lithuania. We've got very long Lithuanian names, which I can manage only the first. So this is Viktorija. They dissolve into a sea of hat checks and dots and umlauts and things after that. And Agnė, who is speaking first? Right, I think we all know that we don't know enough about Lithuanian inflections, and that we should all know more about them. And that's just what we're going to learn right now.
We are very grateful for the invitation and for the possibility to participate in this conference. Thank you very much. 510 Incunabula are kept in 8 different memory institutions in Lithuania. You can see where is. You can see the screen. Where were no printing houses in the 15th century in Lithuania. It is not exactly clear how the books came to Lithuania, as no specific documents remained. The remaining inscriptions from the end of the 15th and from the beginning of the 16th centuries in Incunabula can help to restore the different titles on these books, but often they are anonymous and it is impossible to identify the owners or at least their location. There is one example, the hard red inscription, which reveals that in 1501 the Incunabula was owned by anonymous in Venice. It is unknown how this Incunabula came to the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, but later, in the 16th century, it belonged to the Franciscan monk in Braniewo, Christoforus Medige. He transmitted it to Franciscans in Braniewo. Later, this Incunabula owned the Jesuits in Nisvish. Germany and Italy were two countries from which the main part of the first printed books were delivered to Lithuania. 120 Incunabula kept in Lithuania were printed in Italy. The numbers you can see on the screen. The main part of the Incunabula kept in Lithuania has the inscription which reveals that these books were bought in the biggest printing centers in the Western Europe and brought to the country as early as in the 16th, 17th centuries. Lithuanian students returning from their studies in Europe took their books with them, but mostly Lithuanian book owners bought their books in Commonwealth. We know relatively little about the book's prices. However, Incunabula display this type of content and provide important information about the value of books, the use of money, and at different times and people who bought the Incunabula. From this kind of inscription, we know that the main part of Incunabula were bought in the territory of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. For example, a monk, most like Dominican, Valerianus Camignon, bought works by Thomas de Aquinas from Nicolaus de Noroviensis in Minsk, now Belarus, in 1626 for 20 florins. Later, this monk donated the book to the Minsk Dominicans. It is worth the mention the Antiquitate Judaica by Josephus Flavius, which was in Italy till the 19th century. Monk Petrus Floridus bought the book for 24 thaler from another monk. The name is impossible to read, supposedly between the 16th and 17th centuries. Later in 1974, German classical scholar Benedict Niese bought his book in Rome. During this travel in Italy and France, he was a researcher of Josephus Flavius and he left a lot of German and Latin notes in the book. From Fegelman's Incunabula catalog, it is Lithuanian researcher who researched Incunabula, we get to know that Kaunas University Library bought this Incunabula from the Gustav Fox Antiquary Bookshop in 1928. Most of the old books belong to the monasteries. There is the list of the institution you can see on the screen. Libraries in Lithuania, as in Western Europe, were located near the religious institution, as they took care of the public education and the evangelization in the Grand Duchy of Lithuania. According to the Polish researcher Jakub Mažvydas, one of the most important book collections in the Vilnius monasteries in the end of the 15th and the 16th centuries was the library of the Bernardines. This was the order of the educated people who arrived to Lithuania with their own books. Also here in Vilnius, they created and transcribed the books. They had at least 46 incunabula, six of them printed in Venice and Brescia. Another big Bernardines library was in Kretinga. Up to now, 13 incunabula remained, six of them printed in Venice. Jesuit College in Kražiai had the biggest library in Samogitia. By now, 23 incunabula that belonged to the college are preserved in Lithuania libraries, which with four of them printed in Venice. Many different people donated books to the libraries of the religious institution personally or through their will. In the 17th century, Bernardina monk Jurgis Čechlinskis donated many 15th-16th century books to Bernardinas in Kretinga. It is interesting to mention that until now only six incunabula survived and all of them were printed in Venice. Samogitian bishop Merkelis Giedraitis donated 100 books to the Kražiai Jesuit College. This was the beginning of the college library. At the moment, we know only one incunabula amongst them, and it is printed in Venice. His books are very good source to know more about the trade and the prices of the books in Commonwealth, because many of the books have their prices mentioned in the inscription. The first private libraries appeared during the Renaissance period, when the book itself became a worth. The inscription found in the old books, such as "For me and my friends," "For me and mine," "The mind," reveal one very important fact about the 16th century books, that the book was purchased for the common use. This kind of inscription were made by Lithuanian Lutheran priest, the translator of Lithuanian psalms, Alexandras Rodunionis, in the sermons by Aurelius Augustinus. Rodunionis studied in Königsberg in 1547, and he bought this incunabula there. He paid 24 groschen for the first book and 20 groschen for the second. It is worth mentioning another similar case, the lending. The incunabula bound together with the 16th century book was lent by the vicar of Žasli, Tomas Poplavski, to the priest of Vilnius, Michal Skorulski, in 1612. The priest also made the inscription where he reminded himself not to forget to return the book. Skorulski had his personal library as well. Incunabula were read by many famous Lithuanian cultural figures. The personal library of Prussian Chancellor Martin von Wallenrod is worth mentioning. The library became a public one in 1650 and was merged with the Königsberg University Library in 1999. 30 incunabula from the Wallenrod Library are now kept in Lithuanian libraries, and 9 incunabula amongst them were printed in Italy, Venice and Rome. In this part, I mentioned only a few cases about how incunabula, especially from Italy, were important to Lithuania in the pre-first centuries of their existence. My colleague Agnė will tell further how and why this book moved and changed the owners in Lithuania.
Thank you very much for Viktorija. In her first part, she presented how books arrived, how they were taken to Grand Duchy of Lithuania, and this was much bigger country, much bigger state than nowadays Lithuania. It included part of nowadays Belarus, bigger or smaller part of nowadays Ukraine, a little bit of Poland. And now I will tell how this Incunabula from Grand Duchy of Lithuania arrived abroad to nowadays Lithuania. And the first important event that caused many changes was the third partition of Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth that took place in 1795, when three empires, Prussia, Russia and Austria, divided Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, and Grand Duchy of Lithuania, it disappeared from the maps, it became part of Russian Empire. Of course, Russian Empire started the Russification politics, and this caused many changes. The first of them was oppression of Eastern Rite Roman Catholic Church, so-called Uniate Church. With a few decrees by the Tsar Nicholas I, Uniate Church were returned to the Russian Orthodox Church, and the last step was in 1837, and some institutions became Russian Orthodox, others were simply closed, and the books were carried to other institutions. And here you can see one Incunabula, and you see only one word, Zhirovitsy. It's a monastery in nowadays Belarus. Nearly all books from Zhirovitsy monastery, they have inscriptions that we write one word in one leaf. But we can see that it is written that in Russian, but the book is from the Zhirovitsy monastery library, and it was inscribed to the catalogs in Anno, one word in Latin, in 1758. But after the oppression of Eastern Rite Catholics, this book was brought to Vilnius and to Vilnius Orthodox Priest Seminary, and where it stayed until the beginning of World War II. Of course, the second very important step was Russification of Lithuanian Catholics, this Western or Roman Rite Catholics. So, first of all, after the 1830-32 uprising, Vilnius University was closed, and the theology faculty was transferred into Roman Catholic Priest Academy. So it received some books from the university, but in 10 years, in 42, it was moved to St. Petersburg and to the new St. Petersburg Roman Catholic Theological Academy. So the books were taken with the library, with the seminary itself, and after the revolution, some of the books returned to Lithuania, others to Poland, where the seminary once more moved. The other step was the closing of many Catholic monasteries in Lithuania. Some of them were forbade to have new novices, hoping that with the death of old monks, the monasteries will die naturally. But to tell the truth, it never happened. According to the government of Russian government, they thought that our monks and nuns are nearly immortal. But some monasteries were closed, and the books were given to other, at least to other Catholic institutions. So here you can see that the book belonged to Carmelite monastery in Vilnius, and after closing of the monastery, it was given to the Roman Catholic Priest Seminary in Vilnius. Only that the stamp is in Cyrillic, in Russian, because this was official language of Russian Empire. Some other institutions were forced to move from one city to another. As we can see here, that the book belonged to Jesuit College in Kražiai, in the western part of Lithuania. Later it was given to the priest seminary in the same Samogitia, but because of the political acts, the seminary, first of all, the bishop and later the seminary and other institutions, they moved to Kaunas, to nowadays second biggest city of Lithuania. So seminary also changed its name from Samogitian seminary to Kaunas Priest Seminary, or Metropolijos Kunigų Seminarija in Lithuania. A little bit more freedom Lithuanians gained in the beginning of 20th century, when they were allowed to establish some cultural institutions. And our aristocracy was very interested in doing this. Some of the institutions worked until the beginning of World War II, some others only for a shorter time. And what we can see in this Incunabula, that one nobleman from Vilnius, Tiškevič, gave his book to Tovažistvo Muziejum Nauki iš Tuki. The title is in Polish because this was the main speaking language of Lithuanian nobility. So it gave the book to Society of the Museum of Science and Art, which closed in 1914. And the books from this Museum of Science and Art Society, all of them were given to Society of Science Fellows, to another society that worked until 39. At the same time, the private Wroblewski family's library became public, and it was established in 1912. So it also had some Incunabula from Wroblewski's collection. Some others were given by the same Tiškevič and other people. During the interwar period, Vilnius was part of Poland, so the capital of Lithuania became Kaunas, and new institutions such as university and national library were established there. And Viktorija mentioned one in Incunabula that was bought by Kaunas University Library, with a few, let's say, new books that came to Lithuania. But not so many, most of them were imported to Lithuania before. The main libraries of Lithuania, National Library, Vilnius University Library, and the Library of the Lithuanian Academy of Sciences, enriched the Incunabula collections quite a lot because of Soviet occupation. Well, I don't say that this occupation gave us something good, but only that the society of in Lithuania was radically changed, and these changes caused that many books lost were old and gained new owners. So at the end of World War II, Vilnius at that time was returned to Lithuania and became its capital. It was capital of Lithuania from 1939. But Lithuania was occupied by Red Army, and after the war it became one of Soviet republics. So this caused many changes for the state and its institutions, both regular, religious and secular. Still during the war, if example, the library of Calvinist church, according to the church's will, had to be transferred to the Wroblewski library. Partly this was fulfilled, because many books and manuscripts, different documents were given to this library. Some of the documents were lost during the war. Some of them ended the journey in other places, for example, National Library of Lithuania. But Soviets closed many Roman Catholic institutions as well, monasteries, churches. Vilnius Catholic Priest Seminary was closed in 1945. It was transferred to Poland, to Belystok, and its building and church were given to the library, and so-called Palace of Books was established here, Here you can see the church of St. George in Vilnius and this palace of books. The shelves were made and books were kept here during Soviet times. These photos were made maybe some 10-12 years ago, so it is quite clean and quite nice view. Now the church is empty, it's restituted and now it belongs to the Catholic Church. So at the moment it is closed. So books from the seminary itself, from the monasteries, churches, the ones that belong to Lithuanian nobility, private libraries were kept in this palace of books. Here you can see inscriptions, but the book belonged to the Capitula Vilnensis, later to the Catholic Priest Seminary, and from 45, with closing of seminary, it belonged to Knygų Rūmai, Palace of Books in Lithuania. Some other books... some other books found their place in the Wroblewski Library, the library of the Lithuanian Academy of Sciences, it was called during Soviet period. Amongst the other books, Incunabula were transferred as well. But many of these books, not only the ones kept in the church, were prohibited and accessible only with a special permission. Some institutions were organized as well, and the Incunabula and some other books became unnecessary for the institutions, and they were transferred to the other libraries. As we can see here, that the book belonged to Kaunas University Library from 1940 until 1950, this Kaunas University was reorganized into polytechnics and medicine institutes, so some of the books from the library were given to the Vilnius University Library. One more source that enriched our libraries in 1945 was Königsberg. The city was occupied and devastated by Red Army, but Lithuanian Polish scientists and librarians knew about its big and valuable collection. So Lithuanian expeditions were organized and people tried to save as much as they could. There are stories told about how trucks of books were changed into boxes of vodka. But thanks to this expedition, some very unique documents survived, and not only manuscripts, but also books and Incunabula amongst them. And here you can see one unique Incunabula from Königsberg Library. We don't have ex libris, we have only inscription of Wallenrod Library, and now it is kept in the Academy of Sciences Library in Vilnius. So, we discussed a lot about how to call all these processes, describing them in the main database. So we called them all these changes institutional transfers. Maybe it's not the right term to describe all the processes, but the best of what we have. As you heard from our presentation, a lot of history is hidden under it, and we still have many things to uncover. Incunabula is only a small part of the books that were unwanted and forbidden. The books suffered during the wars until the very end of the 20th century, the same as people. So we need to do a much bigger research to understand what political events caused what changes in the history of our books. And we can only hope that there will be no similar institutional transfers in our future, and we will have enough time and people to reveal all these histories. Thank you for the attention.